Must be all gluttons for punishment to all to be here, but there you are. It's cold outside, so it's warm inside here. So we'll get with it. Stumbling into war. This summer is going to be the 100th anniversary of the start of the First World War. And it was known as the Great War until 25 years later, when yet another outbreak of global conflict caused the first one to be called World War I. The United States didn't join that war until April 1917. But in Europe this summer, you're going to see in the media many sober recollections, and in the war graves in northern France, commemorations of the 100th anniversary. On 28th of June 1914, Archduke Franz Ferdinand, the heir to the Austro-Hungarian Empire, was assassinated in Sarajevo by a young Serb nationalist. And just 6 weeks later, on the 4th of August, the armies of most of Europe were mobilized, and Great Britain, France, and Russia were at war with Germany and Austria-Hungary, and then the Ottoman Empire joined in the war on the side of Germany and Austria-Hungary in October. 4 years later still, by the time that the armistice was declared at the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month of 1918, which is now recognized on the 11th of November every year in Europe as Remembrance Day, by that time the whole world had changed. Kaiser Wilhelm of Germany was forced into abdication, and Germany became a republic. The Austro-Hungarian Empire was broken up into independent countries. The Ottoman Empire itself was in tatters, and in 1923 the Ottoman Empire became the Secular Republic of Turkey. Great Britain was exhausted, a shadow of its former self, and to a large extent saved only by the participation of the doughboys from across the Atlantic. And Russia had had its revolution and the overthrow of Tsar Nicholas in 1917. The numbers and casualties involved were enormous. Altogether, including the United States, some 16 million military and civilians were killed, and almost 20 million were wounded or died of disease, including the Spanish flu, which happened at the end of the war, famine, or went missing. And it was also a war that led directly to World War II. Just over 20 years later, and as we know, it resulted in human losses which were four times as many, and the use of nuclear weapons. Now, I'm sure we all agree, war itself is a nasty, ugly, searing business. And it leaves people dealing with their grief and then living also with their physical wounds, and many others nursing questions of why did it happen? We humans are naturally competitive, and war is sometimes inevitable, but not so in all cases. World War I was a war into which the leadership of the participating countries stumbled as a series of developments unfolded. And those developments, each of which logical at the time and which seemed sensible at the time to the leaders, they led quite unexpectedly, but step by unfortunate step, to consequences that were totally unforeseen when it began. Fast forward to 2014, and today we find ourselves now with two recent wars in Iraq and in Afghanistan, with upheavals in Egypt and Libya and Yemen, with an ongoing savage civil war in Syria and no solution to that in sight, and of course the possibility of military action in Iran if diplomacy fails. And then we also have the fact that China is the rising power. Its economy is going to overtake that of the United States sometime in the 2020s. It is expanding its navy, and it has territorial disputes with several countries in the West Pacific region. All the military actions of the past 15 years, and indeed longer than that, have had unforeseen consequences. And so as we approach the 100th anniversary of World War I, I believe that we would do well to remind ourselves just exactly how nations can, if they're not very careful, stumble into war. Now, some of you, I'm sure, will already have seen at the turn of this year, there have been several articles in the newspapers and in the journals drawing alarming parallels between 1914 and 2014. And in most of them, the authors didn't really explore why and how the Great War started, but they plunged immediately into dark predictions about 2014. I mean, in my view, such articles were unnecessarily gloomy or simply sensationalist. I don't believe that, in fact, there's likely to be a major outbreak of war, providing care is taken. And yet, it's appropriate, therefore, that we look back to see what few lessons were learned. This talk, therefore, is in large part a look back at a period in history when countries stumbled into war, and yet it's also a cautionary tale for the future. Events almost never repeat themselves identically, and yet they can, if we let them, serve as a useful guide to our consideration and our actions for the future. For it was George Santayana, that Spanish and American philosopher and man of letters, who came up with this famous aphorism, "Those who cannot remember the past are condemned to repeat it." And so, in giving a brief overview of the circumstances and the suspicions and the apprehensions and the decisions and the actions that led to the outbreak of war in 1914, I invite you to measure them against those that face the international community and those people of our leaders and our decision makers of the present. So let's look at the 20th century, the first decade. The events that led to the outbreak of war are many and they're complex, and I don't intend to bore you with all of them. But we do need to remind ourselves of some of the circumstances, and particularly some of the personalities who took the decisions, because politics is as much about personalities as it is about the actions that then result. The first 10 or so years of the 20th century were witness to major social and economic change. Great Britain was by far the most powerful country in the world, with extensive colonies and dependencies abroad, trading posts, naval bases, and the largest navy afloat. All these were the results of being the first nation to introduce the Industrial Revolution over 100 years earlier, and then maximizing the benefits of that by a policy of trade and exploration and maritime expansion. But by the time Queen Victoria died in 1901, the commercial and manufacturing edge and the political power advantage of Britain were already beginning to be cut down. Other countries were flexing their developing industrial muscles. In the latter years of the 1800s, Russia was moving from a primarily agricultural economy to an industrial one and growing at 3.5% per year. And by August 1914, Russia was already the fifth among nations in industrial production. In the United States, American exports tripled between the end of the Civil War and the turn of the century. And by 1902, America produced more iron and steel than Germany and Great Britain together, and had 23.8% of world manufacturing against Britain's 18.5%. America produced half the world's cotton and corn and oil, and a third of the world's coal and gold. And you'll recall that in 1905, the Wright brothers had flown 24 miles in 38 minutes, and in 1908, Henry Ford had produced the first Model T, and then he followed it in 1913 with the first moving assembly line. The world in 1914 was changing rapidly. But the biggest change to the old order and stability in Europe was emerging from Germany. And to understand that more clearly, we need first to step back in time. Until 1870, what is now Germany was a collection of North and Central European states, all with German as a predominant language. The most powerful state was Prussia. And from there came the Henry Kissinger of the day, statesman Count Otto von Bismarck, whose complex talents of personality, brilliance and intelligence, and cunning and ruthlessness and strategic skill brought about the principalities together as a unified Germany under Emperor Wilhelm I, Emperor of Germany, King of Prussia. But in 1888, the throne had passed to his son, Wilhelm II. A 29-year-old who was headstrong, highly opinionated, and impulsive. And coincidentally, Kim Jong-un of North Korea was almost the same age as that when he assumed the leadership of North Korea in December 2001. So that's one of the coincidences that are 100 years apart. In 1914, many of the royal families in Europe were interrelated. Wilhelm's mother was English and the daughter of Queen Victoria. Wilhelm developed a love-hate relationship with his mother and his British cousins. On one hand, he was proud of his connections with the monarchy of the most powerful country in the world. And yet, on the other hand, he was deeply jealous of that power and convinced that Germany was not being given the respect that it deserved. In his early 20s, he did his military service and he became a caricature of the young Prussian officer with all the overbearing pride and language and opinions that went with the uniform of a very distinguished Prussian regiment. Relations between the young Kaiser and the 75-year-old Bismarck soon became confrontational, however, and in 1890, the breakdown led to Wilhelm impulsively ordering Bismarck to tender his resignation. And there is this famous cartoon called Dropping the Pilot. It shows Wilhelm leaning over the side of the ship of state, watching Bismarck, or rather glum Bismarck, depart. And here is another cartoon, again, of Wilhelm lolling in the big seat of the throne, and Bismarck waving goodbye, and Germania over in the background looking really quite nervous. You can imagine how bitterly Bismarck received this reward for his services. And he retired from public life, and he died in 1898 at the age of 83. To the south of Germany lay the great Austro-Hungarian Empire, a mixture of nationalities and languages and a conglomeration of territories under the Habsburg monarchy of Emperor Franz Joseph. Austria had become the leader of the Germanic states following the defeat of Napoleon. But the Austro-Prussian War of 1866 had actually resulted in the expulsion of Austria from the German Confederation. And so in Vienna, Emperor Franz Joseph's eyes turned elsewhere. And then he had taken steps to consolidate his relations with the east of Europe and with Hungary in an arrangement that became known as the dual monarchy, which is why it's called the Austro-Hungarian Empire. He continued, however, to have nationalist problems with various components of his empire, particularly in Bosnia-Herzegovina, which he acquired from Ottoman control, and with Serbia and its Slavic connections with Russia. Reigning for 68 years, Franz Joseph was a monarch of the old style. He was austere, self-controlled, reticent, and he had an enormous sense of duty. But inevitably, as change took place in Europe in the late 19th and early 20th century, he'd become left behind by progress. And he was beset by family tragedy. His son Rupert, if you recall, had committed suicide in 1895 in Meerling with his young mistress. And then he had tense relations with the person who then took on as his heir, Archduke Franz Ferdinand, of which, or of whom, I shall speak a little more later. Emperor Franz Joseph remained in power until he died in 1916. So he didn't live to see the collapse of the empire and the disappearance of the House of the Habsburgs. Another empire that was suffering decay was the Ottoman Empire, with its capital in Constantinople, which now is called Istanbul, and under weak leadership. Its decline had progressed throughout most of the 19th century, and it had gradually shrunk in size as parts were lost to, or shall I say, annexed by, or acquired by, or stolen, by stronger European powers. And by the onset of World War I, the empire's territory was largely reduced to the lands, as you can see in here, in the Middle East or the Western Asia. Now, whereas Great Britain was a constitutional monarchy, and political decisions were made not by the king, but by the prime minister and his government, this was not the case in Berlin and Vienna or Constantinople, nor in St. Petersburg, where the Tsar of Russia had his court. These monarchs all had their ministers and generals and advisers from whom they often received conflicting counsel. But the final decisions on such matters as the mobilization of the army and going to war required their personal approval. So much, therefore, then, for the setting the scene of the personalities. The years leading up to 1914 were not only years of economic and industrial change, but also years of social and political unrest. The various peoples of the Austro-Hungarian Empire chafed under the authority of rule from Vienna, and nationalist movements had to be dealt with and put down. And similar pressures were alive in the Ottoman Empire, and the Austro-Hungarian Empire and Russia and Italy and others all took advantage of weaknesses in Constantinople to acquire, by fair means or foul, various pieces of territory in Europe and North Africa. In Russia, the gap between the aristocracy and the boyars on one hand and the workers and peasants living in squalor on the other was bringing strains of its own. There was increasing militancy amongst the factory workers. And in January 1905, there had been a great petition to the Tsar demanding sweeping political changes and economic reforms. But that public demonstration was put down with quite a great deal of vigor and force, and it became known as Bloody Sunday, as several hundreds were killed or wounded. And the elements, therefore, for revolution were stirring. Great Britain was faced with its own problems domestically. At home, there was the growing movement for home rule in Ireland. There were various strikes by miners and others. There was agitation for women's rights by the suffragette movement. And there were concerns about the flood of imports from abroad. Indeed, as early as 1896, there had been a popular pamphlet entitled Made in Germany, in which the author, as you can see here, charged that a gigantic commercial state is arising to menace our prosperity. And he invited readers to look around their houses. The toys and dolls and the fairy books which your children have in the nursery are made in Germany. The tableware, the ornaments, and most of the furnishings were probably made in Germany. Here we are 100 years later, and for Germany, one might read China. Overseas, the sheer extent of the British Empire brought major challenges, among which, for example, were the Boer War, wars in South Africa, in which British troops fought with the Dutch settlers who were claiming independence. And Britain was also concerned about the new Russian railways that were spreading southwards towards Afghanistan and Persia, arousing suspicion that Russia was seeking access to warm water ports and the Indian Ocean, and in turn potentially, therefore, threatening British interests in India. British policy, as far as continental Europe was concerned, was one of splendid isolation. And in general, the policy was aimed at preserving a balance of power by judiciously avoiding any formal alliance with one side or another. In 1904, an Entente Cordiale had been signed with France, with agreements on some colonial matters, but very carefully, Britain had avoided making any assurances about security. And as the French often say, l'Albion perfide. As a maritime nation, Britain's colonial and commercial interests were focused overseas. Much more money was spent on the navy than on the army. And when Wilhelm II in Germany began to show an interest in developing a navy to challenge British superiority, British concerns began to mount. In London, strong voices came from the admirals that modern, well-armed battleships were needed, and the class of ships known as dreadnoughts, of which this is the first, was constructed. And there then followed a very famous naval race of warship building between Germany and Britain in 1906, with each country committing large amounts of treasure to the building of battleships and battlecruisers. And you can see by 1914 the total of battleships and battlecruisers that the two ships had to go into war. Now, throughout the years, these years of change and competition, there was much mistrust and suspicion of ambition and intent. What was seen as a prudent defensive measure by one country was perceived as malign and deliberately threatening by another. Dominating the seas, Britain had little sympathy for the aspirations and concerns of other nations. Germany, on the other hand, under Wilhelm and his proud generals and admirals, was a rising world power, and it wanted its rightful place in the sun. Moreover, Germany, with its population of some 65 million, was able to call on far more men for military service than Britain, with only 40 million, or France, with 39 million. So as far as Germany was concerned, Britain and France had got to be put in their place. And Britain, as the recognized world power, just as the United States is today, was often condescending and insensitive to the fears and concerns of other powers. Convinced that its own values and self-worth were superior to the others, and that its contributions to civilization and the world in general were laudable and just, Britain chose to shield its eyes from the fact that its advantages were slipping away. In 1903, Europe still had chances for peace. And here is a quote from Margaret Macmillan, "The War That Ended Peace." And I'll let you read that while I continue. So 6 weeks of summer then, in 1914, between the 28th of June and the 4th of August. It was apparently a very pleasant summer in Europe in 1914. On the 28th of June, the French president and his wife were at the races. The Chancellor of Austria-Hungary was duck hunting in Moravia. Kaiser Wilhelm was racing his yacht in the Baltic. And General Moltke, his chief of staff, was at a spa. Archduke Franz Ferdinand and his wife Sophie, Duchess of Hohenberg, they were making a formal visit to Sarajevo in Bosnia-Herzegovina. Now, Emperor Franz Joseph himself didn't care much for his nephew, the Archduke. The Archduke was a tall, handsome man. He had a fierce temper and a high opinion of himself, but this was not echoed by his uncle. Matters were made worse when Franz Ferdinand had married one of his ladies-in-waiting, the Countess Sophie Chotek, and his uncle took the view that his nephew had married far below his real status. The Archduke himself loathed Hungarians and Serbs, but he did support a cautious foreign policy. And he'd once said to the Empire's foreign minister, quote, "If we enter a war with Russia, it would be a catastrophe. God help us if we annex Serbia." And indeed, if the difficulties with Serbia had probably been left at him, he would probably have avoided them, resulting in war. But that was not to be. On that Sunday, the 28th of June, the royal couple left their train and took their seats in an open touring car to drive to the city hall, unaware that in the crowd there were seven Serb conspirators with a plan to assassinate the Archduke if and when opportunity presented itself. One of them threw a bomb at the Archduke's car, but it missed and instead landed in another car of the motorcade and wounded some of the staff and the aides, who were then taken off to hospital. However, despite being somewhat shaken by this incident, the visit proceeded, and after the city hall and the lunch, the imperial party returned to the car to visit the military hospital where the wounded had been taken. But along the way, the motorcade took a wrong turn, and the driver of the Archduke's car stopped to reverse and then take the correct route. And unfortunately, he stopped right where one of the conspirators was standing, who then jumped onto the running board and shot the Archduke and his wife at point-blank range. And they were dead, and the Archduke's wife died immediately, and the Archduke himself died just a few hours later. Now, in the following weeks, much discussion took place in Vienna about what should be what the Austro-Hungarian Empire should do in response to this unacceptable provocation, for which it was assumed that not just Serb conspirators, but the Serbia itself was responsible. It was decided to teach Serbia a lesson by issuing an ultimatum demanding certain actions or face the prospect of military intervention. Perhaps that was intended as a bluff in the expectation that little Serbia would back down. But Serbia too had pride and didn't back down. And there were certain elements in that ultimatum which had been deliberately designed to really force it down Serbia's throat. So when Serbia didn't back down, this meant Austria-Hungary either had to go through with its threat or it had to lose face. The Emperor's generals urged that military action should be taken, and this was supported by the civilian chancellor. However, at that point, Russia made it clear that they would view military action against their fellow Slavic cousins with very grave concern, on the grounds that if Russia took no action to support their fellow Slavs, then Russia would lose face. And at this point, Germany then weighed in, pressing that the Serbian outrage demanded strong action. Since 1905, Wilhelm's generals had been preparing plans for a flanking invasion of France. This is known as the Schlieffen Plan. And General Schlieffen had been the chief of the army staff for many, many years. He'd retired by 1914, but it was basically his plan. For a flanking invasion of France in the event of war in Europe. And here now, presented on a platter to them, was a casus belli. Germany's geographical position has always been one of their problems, in the sense that they are situated between France and between Russia, and France and Russia. And General Moltke, who is now the chief of staff, his plan was to invade France through Belgium, as you can see by the arrows, and do this operation so quickly and efficiently that the German troops would be able to take Paris and the operation would be virtually over before cumbersome Russia could mobilize its army. And after defeating France, the plan was then to turn the whole weight of the German force to turn east to deal with Russia. And General Moltke at this stage also expected that Great Britain would stay on the sidelines and not get involved. The French themselves were slow to awaken to the danger of the assassination in Sarajevo. After all, this unfortunate event was just another spot of bother in the Balkans and of no concern to France. However, by late July, they were concerned enough to send troops towards the border with Germany, but with instructions to stay 10 kilometers back from the border in order not to provoke German reaction. In the meantime, Paris made increasingly feverish approaches to Russia to find out what the Russians would do and also what the British would do. L'Albion perfide encore. In London, too, the first reaction was that this matter between Austria-Hungary and Serbia was a storm in a teacup, and it would soon be over. But as July progressed and the diplomatic telegrams flew between capitals, it was decided that as a prudent measure, the British fleet that had been on summer maneuvers should remain partially mobilized. And although this was intended as a simple precaution, yet again, this did not appear so to Germany. On the contrary, it appeared to Germany that this was a threatening gesture, and so the tensions ratcheted up another notch. In the meantime, London gave deliberately opaque verbal assurances of support to France, but carefully avoided giving any firm commitment of military intervention. As July progressed, the situation festered. Step by step, the nation stumbled towards war. Yet, among the various publics of the countries concerned, there was a wide belief that it would all blow over. It was summer. Surely the leaders would find a diplomatic way out. But matters came to a head on the 28th of July, when Austria-Hungary formally declared war on Serbia. Now, in Russia, in the hope that the war could be avoided, the Tsar at first refused urging from his own ministers to mobilize the army. But on 30th of July, he was told by his generals that war would be the only way of preserving his throne, and so he gave in. And by the 1st of August in Berlin, even Wilhelm was having doubts about the wisdom of the military pressure he was receiving. But General Moltke argued that yet further delay would only result in giving more time for the cumbersome Russian army to get properly organized. And so Wilhelm signed the mobilization order at 5 p.m. on the 1st of August, and Germany gave notice to neutral Belgium not to oppose military operations by German troops as they passed through Luxembourg and Belgium en route to France. But little Belgium had a sovereign pride of its own, and unexpectedly for Germany, refused to cooperate. German troops then began to pour into Belgium, and it was this action that finally forced the hand of the British. For Great Britain, German occupation of Belgium gave direct access to the North Sea, and therefore was a threat to naval operations as well as a potential threat of invasion. And so on 3rd of August, Great Britain issued orders for the full mobilization of its army and navy, and on the following day gave its own ultimatum, Germany. It was Britain that declared war on Germany, not the other way round. And when no answer came by the deadline of 11 p.m. on the 4th of August, orders were given in London to commence hostilities against Germany, and so Europe found itself at war. The Kaiser angrily accused the British of betrayal. The publics in most countries thought, well, if they were at war, surely it would all be over by Christmas. General Moltke was of the opinion that the British must have planned this all along, and he actually wondered whether Germany could persuade the United States to come in as an ally of Germany, promising that when Germany won the war, they would give the United States Canada. So, conclusions. What lessons, therefore, are we to draw from this sad tale? And how do current circumstances compare with those of 100 years ago? Now, first, of course, the present circumstances are very different from 1914. In Europe, specific steps have been taken to prevent Europeans from fighting each other. Europeans generally have learnt the lesson of two world wars, that fighting each other really is not a good thing to do. And there are no longer authoritarian monarchs with testy and unpredictable personalities responsible for life or death decisions. Although it might be argued that there are some personalities like that in the US Congress who sometimes display similar proclivities. Secondly, communications and hotlines are much better and much faster than they were 100 years ago. And so fears and misunderstandings can hopefully be addressed before they get out of hand. And in addition, there are now in Europe supranational bodies such as the European Union and the OSCE, the Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe, which are deliberately designed to work out problems and avoid the misunderstandings that might lead to a repeat of World War I and World War II. We should note, however, that there is no such bodies existing amongst the countries that have interests in the Pacific, in the area of the Pacific Rim. There is no body, no international machinery of the same kind. Thirdly, the practice of formal declarations of war between states has largely been replaced by what is known as asymmetrical warfare. Today's enemies are for the most part non-state actors, terrorists and suicide bombers, against whom formal declarations of war and mobilization of forces really have no place. But this in turn also means that governments may be a little out of practice in dealing with mounting crises between themselves. As in 1914, however, mutual mistrust, suspicions of motive, misinterpretation of actions, and misunderstandings of intent continue to abound. Political leaders still have to take decisions amidst conflicting pressures and confusing evidence. You'll recall that in the 1962 missile crisis, President Kennedy was receiving urgent military advice to bomb Cuba, but probably with the wrong advice in mind that he'd been given over the Bay of Pigs, he refused, and instead he came up with an answer that avoided major conflagration. That was a good lesson to us all. Now, in the 21st century, China is the rising power, and there can be little doubt that great caution is going to have to be exercised in Sino-American relations. And it should also be borne in mind that loss of face is taken very seriously indeed by countries on the Pacific Rim, by Asian countries. It means much more to Asian countries than it does to us in the West. China is now increasing its navy and has carried out sea trials with its first aircraft carrier and has a program to build three more. It is also building a new class of ballistic missile submarines. It has a contract to develop the world's second largest copper deposits, which are in Afghanistan. It is developing the port of Gwadar for Pakistan, just outside the Straits of Hormuz, about 50 miles away from the Iranian border. It has carried out a successful mission to the moon, and it has just recently established scientific research bases in the Antarctic. China is stretching its arms. In Global Trends 2030, Alternative Worlds, issued by the US National Intelligence Council in December 2012, there was this assessment. And on November 2013, China declared an air defense identification zone over a part of the East China Sea, including the Senkaku Islands, which are down here. The Senkaku Islands are five islands, uninhabited islands, which have been claimed by Japan, but they're also claimed by Taiwan, and they're also claimed by China. And you can see that they're really quite a long way away from Japan, but that's one of the areas that China is seeking to assert its authority. China declared, by establishing this zone, that in future it would require flight plans of aircraft passing through the area to take defensive and emergency measures against unidentified aircraft entering the zone. From China's point of view, this was a perfectly reasonable exercise of its right to self-defense. And it was also an expression of the fact that it needed to be given the respect that it felt it deserved. Not surprisingly, however, Japan protested as a provocative, threatening gesture. And in the United States, as an ally of Japan, you'll recall that Secretary of Defense Hagel promptly expressed deep concern and said that China's announcement would not in any way change how the United States conducts military operations in the region. On the 29th of November last year, two US B-52 bombers deliberately flew into the area without giving prior warning to China. And since then, there have been other deliberate challenges to the Chinese air defense identification zone. In December, there was also a confrontation at sea when the US warship Cowpens was monitoring the sea trials of the Chinese aircraft carrier and was challenged by ships of the Chinese Navy. In late January, a Chinese Navy flotilla of three ships carried out exercises off the Paracel Islands. And the Paracel Islands are up here. There are about 30 islands uninhabited again, except for a few military outposts and fishermen, claimed by Vietnam, claimed by China, claimed by Taiwan, claimed by the Philippines. And then they went further south to the Spratly Islands, which is down here, to assert the sovereignty over the Spratly Islands. The Spratly Islands, there are about 750 atolls, islets, reefs, cays. It's a very shallow water, very dangerous area to operate in. China has already established a military presence down there and apparently is intending to establish a larger military presence. But you can see that's really quite a long way down in the South China Sea. According to testimony by the Office of Naval Intelligence, quote, the Chinese Navy has ambitious plans over the next 15 years to rapidly advance its fleet of surface ships and submarines, as well as maritime weapons and sensors. And the Office of Naval Intelligence reported that China had laid down and launched or commissioned more than 50 naval ships in 2013 alone. That's Navy and US and Chinese Coast Guard, with a similar number planned for 2014. And in its most recent annual report, the US-China Economic and Security Review, a congressional body of the US government, made this recommendation. The US-China Economic and Security Review is a congressional body. It's not a non-profit organization. It's congressionally licensed. And it recommended Congress should fund the US Navy's shipbuilding to increase its presence in the Asia-Pacific to at least 60 ships. Japan has recently announced that it will increase its defense expenditure to strengthen its capacity to defend the islands it claims in the East China Sea. Japan has got a coast guard of about 450 vessels, which is about the same size, a coast guard, mind you, not navy, about the same size as the Chinese coast guard, and the Chinese coast guard is increasing its size. Both Japan and South Korea have security arrangements with the United States, and so in the event of an outbreak of conflict between them and China, it seems to me that the United States would quickly become involved. The United States could not stand on one side. Now, it would be wrong to draw close parallels. After all, the European war was a war that took place over land. If there are going to be confrontations in the Pacific Rim, it looks as though they're going to take place over water, and therefore they're going to be maritime conflicts. China is too big to be invaded by anybody, just like the United States is too big to be invaded by China. But these actions that I've mentioned are strangely reminiscent of the naval race between Britain and Germany in the early 1900s, and the supportive action that Russia took regarding its own ally, Serbia, when Austria-Hungary delivered its ultimatum to Serbia in July 1914. And then again, we must remember that it was the totally unexpected assassination of Archduke Franz Ferdinand that actually triggered the war. So the rising power of China therefore represents to the United States the risk of falling into what is known as the Thucydides trap. Thucydides was a general and a historian in ancient Greece who declared that the main cause of the First Peloponnesian War in the 5th century BC was the suspicion and fear aroused by one country, one city, namely Sparta, at the rising power of Athens. 2,500 years ago, what goes around comes around. So what options might there be? Of course, one is for the United States to recognize that what happens thousands of miles away from the United States is none of America's business. Another is for China and Japan to set up some supranational body to administer the disputed islands themselves and develop the potential gas fields. You see, the Senkaku Islands are here and there are gas fields around here. And if in fact they could have a supranational body which would sort of put the recognition of sovereignty on one side and talk about the economic aspects and the exploitation, then that might be an option. But again, you'll notice how close Okinawa is to this area, where of course is the furthest US Pacific base. A similar arrangement might be made with China and Vietnam and the Philippines for the Spratly Islands in South China Sea. There is an organization called the Western Pacific Naval Symposium, which was established in 1988, whereby the navies try to come together to discuss maritime problems concerning with the law of the sea and how maritime problems should be challenged, should be dealt with. And perhaps there should be a South China Sea Coast Guard Forum, because there is already a North Pacific Coast Guard Forum where the Coast Guards of the United States and Russia and Japan get together to discuss maritime problems in the North Pacific. But as yet, there is no international machinery down in the South China Sea or the East China Sea to deal with such issues. And then, of course, there is Kim Jong-un in North Korea. Perhaps just as headstrong and impulsive as Wilhelm II. And you'll recall that only 2 months ago, he dropped his pilot, and he executed his pilot, his uncle, Jang Chang. The capital of South Korea, Seoul, is a city of some 10 million people. And being only 35 miles from the North Korean border, it's basically indefensible. Common sense says that there would be nothing to be gained for North Korea to attack South Korea. But Kim Jong-un is unpredictable. And if he thought that his regime was threatened in some way, he might take some sort of dramatic, aggressive action. And in such event, the United States' security assurances to South Korea and Japan are again such that the United States would quickly become involved. A third option might therefore be a proposal from the United States to set up a body rather like they have in Europe, composed of countries in the region, such as China, Japan, South Korea, the Philippines, Vietnam, and the United States, charged with specific functions of exchanging information and heading off any misunderstandings that might lead to confrontation and conflict. Then there is Iran. Iran's nuclear activities have aroused increasing concerns in the international community. And the United States has long-standing guarantees of security assistance to Israel. Resort to military action is on the table. But it needs to be recognized that if ever that's taken, there would be major unintended consequences. And already we have seen that various red lines have been crossed without penalty. And when that happens, they invite the next red line to be misinterpreted as just another bluff. Instead of belligerent threats and steps interpreted as being provocative, the best course of action is diplomacy. And that is what is being tried at present with the current negotiations. But it is as well to back diplomacy with sanctions and the possibility of stiffer action. As Teddy Roosevelt once said, speak softly, but carry a big stick. Separately, the missteps that led to the First World War tell us almost nothing on how to handle the Arab Spring, or the ousting by the Egyptian military of an elected president, or the fundamentalist movements and terrorists of today. These are all problems that the decision makers and the leaders of our nations have to deal with. And perhaps the most dangerous prospect is the unexpected event that acts as a trigger, as in Sarajevo in 1914. Now, we should not be naive. Whether we like it or not, military action will forever be an option in the tool bag of those countries that have sufficient military capabilities. But really, there can be no excuse, surely there can be no excuse for stumbling into war as Europe did 100 years ago. So therefore, what lessons might we draw from the start of World War I? Here are some, and there are probably some others. And you can read those. You see, war, once started, will have unforeseen consequences. Lesson one. Lesson two, precautionary defensive actions by one side may easily be interpreted as the other by the other side as provocative and aggressive. And we've seen that happen in the past many times. Three, the existence of international diplomatic machinery, as I've mentioned, is essential for multilateral discussion, and it doesn't at present exist. And the international machinery doesn't exist on the Pacific Rim. Four, reliable and effective channels of communication are necessary to avoid misunderstanding. And you'll have read recently, a positive action in my view is the visit by General Odierno, the Army Chief of Staff, to his equivalent in the Chinese Army. And those kinds of contacts I think are very good. Each can take the measure of each other, and they all help the personalities to understand each other. So that's one of the aspects of communication. Pressure for military action. The military will always give the best possible military advice. They're not in the business of losing, they're in the business of winning wars. But obviously, it seems to me that decisions should not be taken on the basis of military pressure. Decisions have to be taken for political reasons. Six, in the search for diplomatic solutions, it's important to avoid causing loss of face. As I've said, loss of face in the Far East, amongst the Asian countries, is much more significant than we see it here in the Western countries. And finally, of course, expect the unexpected. So I'm going to end with a couple of quotations. They both refer to World War I, but I ask you also to consider them in the context of 2014. This is by John Keegan, who wrote the book, The First World War, which is widely regarded as one of the best authoritative books about the whole war as itself. And then the final quotation is another one from The War That Ended Peace, Margaret Macmillan, and that last sentence is that there are always choices. This was the French cemetery of the Battle of Verdun. The Battle of the Somme, which began on the 1st of July 1916, 57,000 British casualties on the first day. Over 19,000 killed, and the remained so severely wounded that most of them couldn't return to the war. That was one day. The Battle of the Somme went on from July 1916 to November 1916. Battle of Verdun, which was further south, took place between the French and the Germans between February and December 1916. The French lost 146,000 killed, and the Germans lost 153,000 killed. The flower of the youth of both two countries. And there you see them, the cemeteries stretching as far as the eye can see. That's what happens when countries stumble into war. There are always choices. Thank you very much. Now, we have 20 minutes for questions, discussion. So anybody, yes please.
You mentioned the problem with the little islands and the fact that we could be pulled in because of our agreements with Japan and with another country there, Philippines,
yeah.
Whatever. And then you mentioned North Korea. Who does North Korea call on? Who's in our position because they're backing up North Korea? What country is it, China?
Yeah, China. Who's standing at the back of North Korea? The only country that's standing at the back of North Korea is China. And even China must feel rather concerned, I would imagine, because they can't control Kim Jong-un. The uncle, Jiang Qiang, Kim Jong-un executed, was in fact one of the best connectors to China. And he, in fact, had been rather urging, so I've read, been urging that North Korea must really sort of modernize and start adopting. In other words, China has made the communism work economically, so far as we have seen, and I think he was urging that North Korea should do the same. Now, of course, one of the problems is that of authoritarian dictators, when in fact they support themselves by having a strong military, then they, of course, have constantly got to feed the appetite of that military. And that's what is the situation. So, in fact, North Korea, with a population of 22, 24 million, has over a million men and women under arms, and has got to keep feeding that appetite. So I think China itself must at times be feeling rather nervous that if in fact something happened and North Korea took aggressive action, China itself would feel, well, on the one hand, it better support its North Korea, but it doesn't want to get pulled into a conflict needlessly over that, because it won't be of any benefit to China if they did. Ralph.
Bringing this up to yesterday, you quoted there that committee that recommended we lay down keels for 60 ships in the U.S. in light of the Dempsey, the Dempsey-Hagel recommendation yesterday of reducing our military to where it was in 1940. What do you think of the likelihood of that ever happening at this point?
So the question for those of you at the back who might not have heard is that in light of the statement by Secretary of Defense Hagel and the Chairman of the Joint Chiefs, General Dempsey, yesterday about reducing the U.S. military down to 450,000, what is the likelihood of this being accepted? I should think the likelihood is not much, because this is a recommendation to Congress, and nothing seems to come out of Congress these days. On the other hand, the President has already declared, if you remember, the pivot from facing eastwards to Europe to facing westwards to the Pacific. And I must say, one of the things, after I retired, I was invited to take part in U.S. military exercises in the Pacific Rim. And they were organized by the United States Pacific Command in Hawaii. And I take my hat off to the Pacific Command over there, because they have seen China coming over the hill for quite some time. And they basically decided that if that was going to happen, what they should do is improve and have good relations with other nations in that area. And so each and every year there have been annual exercises that they have with Thailand, which I was not involved in, but other exercises. And they went to countries like India, Indonesia, Thailand, Cambodia, Vietnam, and said, look, would those countries like to have military exercises with the United States? And those countries sort of said, well, yes, they would, but there was a political problem. Namely, the only circumstances under which their government would likely to be involved, allow them to be involved with the United States, was if there would be a UN Security Council resolution. And so and this is where I thought there was sensible action being taken by US Pacific Command. If that's the price of doing business, we will design an exercise which is hypothetically there will be a UN Security Council resolution. Hypothetically, there will be a multinational force. Complying with American tradition, we will not put any American troops under UN command, but we will jointly train as if there was a situation where the UN was present. And in order to do that, they needed to have some people role play certain positions, certain people who had UN experience. A UN presence, a UN military presence, is always military, political, civilian, police, law, and it is always run by a civilian. Even the general has to answer to the civilian. And I was asked to go and role play the position of the senior UN person. And so I saw those kinds of things going on. So fundamentally, I think the US Pacific Command and the naval side is certainly their eyes are wide open as to what is happening. And I think from the point of view of this recommendation was basically something to bolster what the US Pacific Command is also already trying to do. Now, whether in fact, of course, they will have enough ships. The United States has got 11 aircraft carriers, but you don't have 11 aircraft carriers at sea all the time. But on the other hand, as far as China's concerned, they see U.S. aircraft carriers operating out of Japan and operating out of Okinawa. And of course, they begin to feel that that is their backyard. And if I might put the boot on the other foot, the day that a Chinese aircraft carrier appears off San Francisco, can you imagine what the U.S. the U.S. Congress and the U.S. media will say? But that's all, that in fact is the other side of the coin. Mary, you know?
How does technology play into this whole picture when everything that we use is made in China? And these are things that are on these ships.
Yeah, how does technology play into this this whole picture when everything we use is made in China? Fortunately, not everything that we use is made in China. but you can't help but feel that sometimes the Chinese have a very good idea of what's going on. And certainly the hacking that goes on and the cyber warfare and all these other things, and these are matters of great concern. As we all know, the Chinese are not dumb. They're technologically very clever.
Why do we keep producing everything there?
Why do we keep producing? Because
it's from the economics.
Well, you know, I'll ask you in future not to go to Walmart and buy things for, you know, all right, or buy anything else. I have a mug. I wish I brought it. You know, during the Second World War, there was a phrase produced by the British government, a poster: "Keep calm and carry on." Right? Remember that? So you've seen that? I've got a drinking mug at home that says "Keep calm and carry on," and you turn it over, and underneath it says "Made in China." God damn it! You know. Axel,
there is no emphasize very much what makes a country get into war, and you did not mention what happened in the United States at the time of Woodrow Wilson, when there was a diplomatic presence from Germany that was extremely hostile and working to undermine this country, including planting bombs in St. Patrick's Cathedral in New York and all sorts of things like that. And so what convinced Woodrow Wilson to move and join the West?
Yeah, what convinced Woodrow, President Woodrow Wilson in 1917 to join the war? I think that the main argument, I mean, firstly, he was a man of peace, as you and I know, right? He certainly didn't want to join. Also, he was aware that there were, in America, there was a certain community that wanted to support Britain, but there was also a strong community that wanted to support Germany. And therefore, he had to sort of maintain the balance. But what eventually drove him over the edge was the German decision to have unconditional submarine warfare. And once Germany decided that the way to stop Britain was to stop its importation of all the foodstuffs and the other things that it needed, and to cut off the maritime lines of communication, then the way to do that was to have unconditional submarine warfare. And so German submarines started torpedoing American merchant ships, and that was the thing that clicked them over. Yeah, Paul.
You pointed out the absence of international diplomatic machinery to kind of oversee this process and prevent some of these events that might lead to war. Can you envision anything that might be a parallel structure in today's world that would deal not only with nation states, but more would target the dangers that emerge from suicide bombers and terrorism? I mean, what might be in place to deal with these elements that are not nation states and introduce this whole new...
So the question really is that there's no international machinery to deal with disputes between governments, but what kind of machinery might be envisaged to deal with asymmetrical warfare, terrorists and suicide bombers? And I think that's one of the problems that is facing us at the moment. There really is no kind of machinery to deal with individuals like that. It's something very foreign to us, brought up as we are, that somebody will willfully strap on explosives around themselves and drive a vehicle in and willfully commit suicide. Actually, committing suicide, as I understand it, is against the Muslim religion. But lo and behold, there are these fundamentalists doing it. And at the moment, I think it's one of the problems that is facing us in this modern world, just exactly how, in fact, can one come to grips with things like that? Fortunately, these things have, apart from 2001, have not happened. You know, the World Trade Center have not happened over here. America, as I often say, some of you have heard me say this before, America is very lucky with its geography. You know, Europe, as I showed you from the map, you look at Ukraine at the moment and the number of countries that it shares a border with and the difficulties that are going on. But America, you have 3,000 miles of fish to the east and you have 6,000 miles of fish to the west. You share your borders with only two countries, one of which you take for granted, Canada, and it pisses them off no end, and the other one, Mexico, right? So fundamentally, America is extremely lucky. Much luckier than virtually any other country in the world over things like that, and that I think has helped protect United States against some of the ambitions of terrorists. I mean, goodness knows, there are, as I understand it, there are several hundred British militants taking part in the war in Syria, and sooner or later they're all going to return to UK. And when they return to UK, one has to wonder whether there's going to be another surge of terrorist-type acts in Britain, because they exist. It is one of the big problems facing us. You're right. Yes?
Switching for a moment to another part of the globe, have you had a chance to think about and react to what took place recently in the Ukraine, what Russia's reaction might be, what the reaction of other countries might be to...
Yes, I'm asked for my thoughts about what has been happening in Ukraine. Ukraine is a country of some 45 million people, 700 miles from east to west, 450 miles from north to south. The eastern and southern part speak Russian and are close to the Russian border and have strong links with Russia. The western and northern part speak Ukrainian. So there's problem one. You have a country of 45 million people. There's a larger number who speak Ukrainian because they happen to live in the west. Crimea, during the at the bottom, which Khrushchev gave Crimea to Ukraine when Ukraine was part of the Soviet Union. So Crimea is part of Ukraine, but on the other hand, Moscow has made very clear that its naval base, its major naval base in the Black Sea, is in Crimea, and therefore it has a long-standing, right up to the middle of this century, a treaty with Ukraine for them to for that naval base to remain. So you have a strong Russian military presence, naval and military presence. Added to which, during the war, during the Second World War, when the Germans invaded Ukraine and there was some fierce fighting, Ukraine lost about 4.5 million people fighting against the Germans. But when the war was over, Stalin decided that the Ukrainians had not really done very well, and particularly down in Crimea, where the Crimean Tatars, and he exercised a pogrom and had them all exiled to Kazakhstan. And he replaced them with Russians. And so most of the, although many of those Tatars have come back, the fact is that there are Russian families, Russian tradition, Russian loyalty in Crimea and down in the Donetsk and the Don Basin, where in the southeastern side. So fundamentally, the situation is that whoever is in charge of the government in Ukraine has got a problem. Then on top of that, there has been massive corruption. And Ukraine needs not only financial support, but it needs natural gas. And where does that natural gas come from? It comes from Russia. And Russia has been giving it at fairly cheap. So in future, although Russia won't put, I don't believe Russia will put military forces into Ukraine, the fact is that Putin is no fool. He's going to charge a price. Firstly, he's going to remove the offer of a $15 billion loan and say, okay, you're bankrupt, you're not going to have any Russian money, what are you going to do? And secondly, he's going to sort of say, I think it's about time you started paying the proper price for our gas. Now, in the meantime, the European Union had extended to Ukraine a partnership agreement to go for Ukraine to become some sort of partnership arrangement. Not a full member of the European Union, but a partnership arrangement. But all of a sudden, Europe, which already has got some weak economic problems in Greece and in Portugal and Italy, certainly doesn't want to buy into have another bankrupt country dumped onto his back. So fundamentally, European Union is going to be faced with the problem of how on earth is it going to provide to cover this $15 billion gap. And of course, a lot of the people in Europe will say, what's the business of spending $15 billion to help Ukraine when you're not helping Greece and you're not helping Portugal, not helping, right? See what I mean? Then that leaves the International Monetary Fund, the IMF. The IMF has had difficulties with Ukraine in the past, and they've become so frustrated in trying to have negotiations with Ukraine, because Ukraine will promise things, but virtually before the IMF team can get across the border and back out to Washington or wherever, the Ukrainian parliament has gone back on the agreement and has let it down. So in fact, there is a big problem. So I suspect that we're going to see a lot of upheaval in Ukraine, a lot of difficulties, some sort of solution, I think, will be found to try to help them in a short term. But whether, in fact, the Ukrainians, who don't have a good track record for keeping to their word, and the whole place is rife with corruption, and once you have corruption so inset in the soul, which it is in Ukraine, you can't just suddenly overnight and sort of say, yes, we'll have a democratic revolution, we'll have a democracy will arrive. So Ukraine is going to be a big problem. Yes, sir, Steve.
Derek, going back to the Pacific, would you say a little bit more about Sino-Japanese relations? It seems to me that the potential flashpoint for real conflict in the region between those two great powers and the antipathy of the Chinese toward Japan dating back to Japanese behavior during World War II and really across all of Southeast Asia remains very, very strong. I just wonder how you feel the relations between those two countries might be managed by them or by friends, in a way that prevents the kind of conflict that now looks more likely than we've seen for many years.
Yes, so basically the question is how about the relations between China and Japan and the antipathy that exists between them and the risk that something might get out of control. Japan invaded China in 1937. Between 1937 and 1945, when the Second World War ended and Chiang Kai-shek was driven out, before Chiang Kai-shek was driven out to Taiwan, but 1945, 37 to 45, China lost 14 million people. 14 million. Those of us who concentrate on the Second World War and think of it in terms of what was going on in Europe and what was going on elsewhere tend to sort of, and this is particularly coming from my direction, the British direction, tend to be really rather ignorant of what went on in this part of the world. And then when China sees, and that is why China, Japan incidentally, claims the Senkaku Islands and that string of islands down there, because China was not in a position to do anything about it. Now, when Prime Minister Abe of Japan goes to the Shinto shrine, where is the shrine to the war dead of Japan, that really irritates China no end. Because China regards that several of the actions of the Japanese who are commemorated at the Shinto shrine are in fact war criminals. And China then gets extremely hostile about that. And certainly, I think the chances are, as I mentioned, China now feels it necessary to spend much more money on defense. China has not fought a war since 1945. Because of the Constitution that was imposed upon it from Washington, but the fact is that they do have a fair
Japan
has not fought a war since 1945, because of the Constitution. But they do have quite a strong navy, and as I mentioned, they have over 450 Coast Guard ships, and they certainly intend to extend it. So there are going to be confrontations between the Chinese Navy and the Japanese Navy down in that East China Sea. I think it's going to be very difficult. One would hope that both countries will have more sense than to let these things get out of hand. One would hope that the United States, does not in fact recognize the sovereignty, the claims by either country to those islands down that island chain, one would hope that the United States also will counsel Japan on to really not let matters get out of hand. But the fact still remains that I think they will get out of hand. There are going to be naval confrontations. There are going to be conflicts in the course of the next couple of years, if not more, between Japan and China, as each of them build up their navies and their coast guards. And as I say, in the end, China basically is demanding the respect that it believes it deserves, and if it feels it's not getting that from Japan, it will probe and it will push and it will create situations. Sorry, I was over here. One more, yes, sir.
Well, there's only been one brief mention of the United Nations tonight. Are you seeing them as basically unable to negotiate and deal with these?
Yes, I am. There's only been one mention of the United Nations, and are they going to be unable? Yes, they are going to be unable, because two of the members of the permanent of the Security Council, two of the permanent members, are China and the United States. And whatever the United States will put forward will get vetoed by China. And if necessary, if ever China gets things put forward, it will get vetoed by the United States, or it will not be agreed to. So fundamentally, for all the good words, and I know this from my own experience in the United Nations, for all the magnificent words in the Charter about peace and justice and all the rest of it, the fact is that when elephants roll over, the mice have got to keep out of the way. This is the situation, I think, with China and the United States. The other aspect is that although China has not fought a land war since 1980, and that was against Vietnam, and relations with Vietnam are not good, and a sea war was an argument with Vietnam over the Paracel Islands that I mentioned before. The fact is that China contributes far more troops to the UN peacekeeping than the United States does. And the United States, in fact, contributes virtually nil. And it always has had this attitude that it won't put its troops under foreign command, and that includes anybody in command of a UN peacekeeping force. So China is actually, through having its troops in various places of peacekeeping, is actually projecting its reputation and its influence in a much more positive way than fighting wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, if you see what I'm getting at. Huh? And amongst all that, it's very difficult for the United Nations to actually really, really have a say. So thank you all very much indeed. Thank you.